But let me just say also, to add to that, it's more than that. It's not only a tragedy, it's criminal, that these are the most interesting, among the most interesting and fascinating intellectual achievements. Again, forget the practicality, the ideas that science has exposed, and it's just criminal and sad to think no more than would we want to have a child grow up without having some understanding of them, some exposure to them, then we would want a child to not never be exposed to Shakespeare.
Exactly. One of the stupidest things Sherlock Holmes ever said was the first thing he said to Dr. Watson. He divulged in conversation with Watson that Holmes didn't know something about the names of the planets, I mean Jupiter and Saturn and things like that. And Watson was absolutely shocked, and rightly so. And Holmes said, "But Watson, I don't need to know about the planets in order to solve my criminal cases." That is such a short-sighted view. It's well, Conan Doyle was, as you know, believed in fairies, so.
Well, I just think you were curious, perhaps positive side effect of that, the evolution and these other questions are why I thought it's in the U.S., which is doctors, social scientists, lawyers, for whom the definition of itself and their statement of their beliefs is very much tied up with science. So anecdotally, to compare Europe, at least in my experience, to compare this to the godless Europe, at least in my experience, you find when talking to a doctor or a social scientist, in other words, an educated layperson, that they find these topics much less interesting and much less part of their day-to-day experience, even if they got a good science education in school. So how do you maintain that sort of live fire within the non-scientist's heart for science once you've settled the stupid question?
No, I think, I mean, that for me, that comes back to what I said before. Before someone will listen to you, you have to get them to be interested. And I think the big problem, maybe it's not a problem, but for many people, they just don't find the questions interesting. And I think, if I thought the questions weren't interesting, I wouldn't be doing it. But what I found is if you find the right way to seduce someone into being interested in those things, then the well opens up, and it's just a sea of questions, because they are basic issues. Where do we come from? Where are we going? Are we alone in the universe? What are we made of? And so I think one has to just overcome the tragic de-education that we do in this country. I mean, here's a scary statistic. So we compare American students to their counterparts in 20, 25 other industrialized nations. And there was a recent study that you may have heard came out. So we look at kids in grade 3 and grade 5 and then 15-year-olds. And what's amazing is in grade 3 and grade 5, American students on the whole do better in science and mathematics than their counterparts around the world. But by the time they're 15, they do substantially worse. So we've been doing something very effective to de-educate them or disinterest them in science. And one of the reasons is another equally scary fact, which is that over 90% of middle school science teachers in this country have never taken a science course outside of high school. And
What percentage was
over
that?
Over 90%.
90,
yeah.
Not 9.
No, 90. And I saw it happen to our daughter when she was in school. In grade 2, I remember going into her school, you know, and I mean, what do you do in grade 2? It's like it's light during the day, dark at night. I mean, those are the kind of things you're talking about. But the teacher was terrified, and that could not help but get across to the students that it was scary, it was terrifying, it was complex. And so it is a problem that we convince our students, partly because we have people teaching who don't feel comfortable with it, that they should feel uncomfortable and interested. And you know, And you can do very well. I taught at Yale University for what seemed like an eternity, and I've learned that you can become very successful in this world with not only just being scientifically literate but proudly proclaiming it. And it's unfortunate. It really is.
So those who reject evolution are hypocritical if they go
Well,
they would deny that, actually,
yeah.
Because they...
Everything in modern medicine comes out of evolution. Can you show one development which has been made without evolution, without the bedrock of evolution? I mean, they should read the Bible instead of going to the hospital.
And obviously, I'm very sympathetic to that. There was a cartoon to that effect, which was going the rounds of the internet. How did it go? It was a fellow in a doctor's office, and the doctor was warning him about antibiotic resistance. I'm not going to remember it. Do you remember this?
Yeah, no,
this,
I'm trying to remember the.
Anyway, okay, forget it. It doesn't matter. Look it up. It's fun. But I think that if you were to talk to a creationist of, I was going to say any sophistication, but I'm not sure that such a thing exists. They would say something like, oh, we're quite happy with microevolution.
Yeah.
It's only macroevolution we worry about. And the mutation and selection of a pathogenic organism in a hospital, that's all microevolution. That, unfortunately, they get a lot of aid and comfort from some circles in biology who add fuel to that by pretending that there really is a distinction between microevolution and macroevolution, instead of realizing that, as we've known since the modern synthesis, macroevolution is just microevolution going on for a very long time. And that's one of the problems that people have in understanding.
Well, I think to add to that, I think I've gotten in trouble because I've exactly written that, and not so much in terms of evolution, but I argued and I that if you say the Earth is 6,000 years old, you shouldn't drive a car, you shouldn't get in a plane. Do you know anything? Because you're being hypocritical, because all of these things depend. The thing is that people don't realize the connectedness of science. So it's okay. They think it's just a bunch of separate stories, and that's often the way we teach it. And it's okay not to believe this part of the story, but you should believe that part of the story. But at the same time, the thing is, at some basic level, what always amazes me is no matter what people say, they ultimately realize that science is the way to go when it comes to concerns. For example, President Bush said we should teach both intelligent design and evolution because we should teach students what the debate is all about. Now, that is not an intrinsically stupid statement, surprisingly, but it's actually quite rational. What it represents is ignorance, and not ignorance in a pejorative sense, ignorance of the fact that there is no debate. But the interesting thing is, when the avian flu became a big issue in this country, what you heard was the president say we have to quickly determine how fast it's mutating from birds to humans. You never heard one person in his administration say, it's been designed to kill us. just forget about it. So at some point, people understand that when really it comes to the crises, no matter what they say to pollsters, it's amazing to me that we're so bimodal or whatever that we can just sort of say, okay, we really need the science because it's the only thing that's going to save us.